Hello, and welcome to our service for Sunday the 11th of April. My name's Sarah, and it's a pleasure to be your host today. I hope you've all been able to enjoy the weather over the last couple of weeks and been able to get out and meet family and friends now that restrictions have been lifted. I've been out quite a lot the last couple of weeks, but not at a time of day I'm usually up and out. My 16-year-old daughter Molly has been waking me up at 6:30 every morning. For those of you who don't know, Molly has got a flock of rare breed Porton sheep, and at the moment they're lambing, so every morning we have to go and check to see if everyone's okay. So it's been really chilly some mornings. We've had to scrape the car and be dressed up in our hats and coats and gloves, but we've been rewarded with some absolutely beautiful sunrises and clear blue skies, and we've watched the hawthorn bushes coming out into blossom. On Maundy Thursday, we arrived at the field and were rewarded with the first lamb. She was only about an hour old, but she was already up on her feet and feeding from her mum. It just made me really appreciate the miracle of God's creation and the new life as we continue through the season of springtime. We need to go up and check on the sheep later, so I'll let you know if there are any more new arrivals. In a moment, we'll be listening to a song from Noel Richards, and then Richard will be reading from God's Word. Then, we will be going on a journey with two of Jesus' friends as they travel from Jerusalem to Emmaus and get talking to someone who gives them a very big surprise. But let's begin our service with a prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we do not come as guests, but as members of your family. We do not come in fear, but with joy and thanksgiving. We do not come alone, but with all your people of every age and in every place. Lord, we come as your family, for you are our Heavenly Father, and Christ is our brother, our Saviour and Redeemer. Amen.
When Tricia and I wrote this song, we could not have imagined how it would travel around the world. The opening line is taken from Psalm 19, "The heavens declare the glory of God." Let's worship together. All heaven declares. Thank you.
reconcile man to God. Wherever you will be, the Lamb upon the throne, I gladly bow the knee and worship you
So today I'm reading from Luke, it's chapter 24, and we're looking at verses 13 to 35, captioned on the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. Now, as they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. They were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened in these days?"
"What things?" he asked.
"About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what's more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself." As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he was going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he walked and talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them, assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread.
Two people, moving and marching, thinking, head scratching about something big that's just been happening. But on the road to Emmaus from Jerusalem way, two became three as another says, "Hey, hey," says he, "you've been thinking and head scratching. Has something big just been happening?" "You've not heard about what's been happening? All of Jerusalem have been head scratching." "What have I missed?" asks the man. "I'd love to know. Please tell if you can." "It's about a man called Jesus, and we thought he was coming to rescue God's people and send the Romans off running. He did, and he said loads of cool stuff from a place up north called Nazareth. He told great stories and healed the sick. He knew people by name and what made them tick. Oh, remember that wedding? He turned water to wine, brought his friend back to life, and his friend felt just fine. He was sharing and caring, just ask his friend Pete. He walked on the water with only his feet. He said shush to the storm and the storm was hushed. He did a miracle with bread and thousands were stuffed. Besides all this, his sermon up a hill had so many stories, super cool and brill. I can't believe it. What a big loss. A man so great who hung on a cross, and on that cross, that's where he died. I feel so tied up in knots inside. And 3 days have passed, though it feels more like 70, because now we've heard that his tomb is empty. That's right, you heard me. His body is gone. But who'd take his body? He never did wrong. You seem confused and out of the picture. So let me show you what it says in the scripture. It was always the plan, right from the start, because Jesus loved you with all of his heart. He died on the cross, but rose from the tomb. He came back to life so you can live too. And as they were moving, and still head scratching, two of them stopped, but the third kept on marching. Hey, don't go, please, the two say. The sun's gone to bed, so why don't you stay? Good point, says the third. Day has turned to night. I'll stop over with you two and then grab a bite. And as they sit down to eat, they close their eyes. He thanks God for the grub, then what a surprise! The two people stare and then rub their eyes. It's Jesus, not gone, but fully alive! And before they say seconds, there's more bread going round. Jesus just vanishes. He cannot be found. The two are left thinking and really head scratching. They'd just been with Jesus. Something big was happening. We must say we've seen Jesus, so tie up your shoes. Quick, to Jerusalem. There's no time to lose. All along it was Jesus, the very same one. They were searching the scriptures with God's precious son. It's the biggest story that's ever been told. About Jesus who's risen, it never gets old. The two met with Jesus in the most surprising way. They shared the story, and we still share it today.
Well, Molly and I have come back up to the field to see if any more of the ewes have lambed. And it's pretty cold up here. We've got snow blowing around. So much for lambing in April when we thought the weather might be good. But we've got no more new lambs today. But the ones you can see just here, being very sociable and walking away, that was the little lamb who was born on Maundy Thursday. So as you can see, the rest of the sheep are just milling around, nibbling on the grass. So we'll have to pop up later on to see if we've got any more. Well, as you can see, it's pretty cold up here, but we're going to continue now with Wonderful Love, sang by our music group, and then Jackie's going to lead us in our prayers. Following that, Annette will be giving us a tour, and then we'll have another song from our music group. So I'll catch up with you later on.
Gives me the time to
to change, washes away the stains that once covered me, and all that I have I lay at the feet of the wonderful Savior who loves me. His breath, forgiveness for me. Wonderful love, whose power can break every chain, giving us life again and setting us free. And all that I have, I lay.
We come now to a time when we are going to be praying for others, both near and far. And let us start by praying for the world that we live in. Lord, mass communication has had many benefits for many people. Global travel has let us see the world, parts of the world which we would never have thought possible. But with that, of course, comes risk. And we're seeing that at the moment with the spread of the COVID-19 pandemic. I thank you, Lord, so much for the speed with which, in this country at least, vaccinations were prepared and have been rolled out to many people across the land. But we know, Lord, that in many other parts of the world, that isn't the case. And I pray that through the COVAX scheme, the excess vaccine is used in places where there would be little hope. I thank you for all the people involved in it. And I pray that it reaches the right people in the right place, at the right time. I just put that in your hands, Lord. Lord, in this country, we're coming to a time of local elections, and I pray for decency, honesty, integrity, and truth to be told in this nation as we come to elect people locally who have our interests at heart. And I pray too, Lord, for our own family and friends, people within our own congregation and in our own circle of friends who have been struggling at this time. I thank you, Lord, for the way that you have enabled me to continue in my business over the last 12 months. But I also pray that as we start to open things up and businesses which had to close are now able to reopen, that they do have clients, they do have customers, but that we don't race to go back to some sort of mass emptying into the streets, the pubs and the clubs from our homes, but that common sense will prevail and that people are courteous and kind, but do enjoy each other's company. It's been a really difficult year, Lord, and it isn't over, but everything we do, Lord, everything we think, say and do, we place firmly into your hands, because you are our sovereign Lord yesterday, today and tomorrow. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Welcome to Sheldon Road Methodist Church and to the first Sunday after Easter. My name is Annette. I'm a local preacher and I'm also a member of Sheldon Road Methodist Church. What I'd like you to do, please, is to get a piece of paper and a pen, because I'm going to ask you to write something very shortly. Now, when my father and stepmother were alive and I spoke to them about work issues and sought their advice, mostly about things that I was really, really worried about, my stepmother used to say, "Is this really going to matter in 100 years' time?" And I kept those words because I thought they were very wise, and sometimes when I feel overwhelmed with worry and concern and I'm not thinking straight, I stop and I remember her words. Does it really matter, or will it really matter in 100 years' time? So, what I'd like you to do is to pause the video and write down a list of things, circumstances, issues, whatever is important to you. Now, if you are sharing this service with others, and if you feel comfortable to do so, I would suggest that you discuss your list with those around you. If you are on your own, then after you have written your list, I invite you to reflect on it and think about what is really important to you. So, what was on your list? There are many things in this world that conspire to distract us, to keep us from being mindfully aware and attentive to the important things or issues, or the important things that really matter. No wonder we feel confused and overwhelmed. We are inundated in our daily lives to outside pressures, advertising, the media, and it must be really hard for our young people with the internet and all the social media stuff, which didn't exist when I was a teenager and a young adult. So, how do we learn to focus on the important issues, the important things in life? And I will come back to that later in this talk. What I would like to focus on now is the Bible passage, which Richard has read to us this morning. Following the crucifixion and death of Jesus, today's passage from Luke takes us to a couple of disciples traveling out of Jerusalem on the road to Emmaus. Were they aware of what was important? Were they going in the right direction? Right direction, wrong direction, we don't know. Along comes a stranger who joins them on their walk. But is he a stranger? We know he's not a stranger. We know he is the risen Jesus from verses 1 to 12 earlier in Luke chapter 24. And we also know about his earlier encounter with men and women at the tomb. The disciples in today's passage do not recognize him. Why not? Did he look so differently? We are told at verse 16, their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Did God blind them? Or did they simply not know who he was? Patiently, Jesus walks with them and asks them what they're talking about. They're really shocked that this stranger is unaware of the events of the last few days. So they begin to share with the stranger how Jesus, whom they hope would redeem Israel, had been crucified, died, and was buried. They also said that some women were telling an amazing story about not finding his body in the tomb and seeing angels who claimed Jesus was alive. At this point, Jesus was not so patient with them and said, "Foolish men, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have declared. Did the Messiah have to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" Next, Jesus gives us a run, a junior church run through lesson, and we will have seen this from the video that was played earlier in the service. He goes on to interpret the scriptures for them and show how the prophets had foretold what all that had occurred. Jesus was addressing the minds of the disciples, and he was attempting to lead them into understanding what had happened and, most importantly, why. So what had happened and why? This is not to understand that the emotional has nothing to do with believing. The important thing was for the disciples to understand why it was necessary for these things to happen to the Messiah, i.e. the crucifixion, his death, and then his resurrection. Unfortunately, even after this lengthy teaching moment, the disciples still did not understand. Finally, when they eventually get to Emmaus, their destination, the disciples invite the stranger to come and eat with them. At the dinner table, it happens. Jesus sits down, takes a loaf of bread, blesses and breaks it and gives it to them. Suddenly, in an instant, the disciples recognize Jesus as he vanishes from their sight. So as soon as they understand, he's gone. In the breaking of the bread, they recognize Jesus. Sometimes the best way to understand is through action. Do it and then talk about it. And that is what Jesus does. He does something that is uniquely him. He does something that causes the disciples to recognize him, and they finally understand. So, what is the relevance of the passage to us today? What are we supposed to understand from this passage? The story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus offer guidance in focusing on the important things. At verse 9, Jesus asked the disciples, "What things?" meaning what things happened in Jerusalem. For us, Jesus asks, "What things are the important things?" What things are the important things? Am I fulfilling God's intention for me? Am I using my gifts to the full? Am I going in the right direction? Let's look at this last question. Am I going in the right direction? The two disciples were heading out of Jerusalem, literally and also metaphorically. They were going home. They were possibly giving up after the events of the last few days. They were possibly throwing in the towel. At first, Jesus doesn't scold them, but walks with them. This shows God's patience, who is willing to walk with us even when we are headed in the wrong direction. God does not abandon us even when we are determined to leave Jesus behind and go. Jesus stays with them on their walk in the wrong direction and prods them to reflect not only on the things that have happened, but also biblically on those things. When the disciples still don't get it, Jesus then interprets the scriptures for them, and he shows them why it was necessary for the Christ to suffer, die, and rise again. What this says is that we cannot always figure things out for ourselves. We need help in identifying the important things. And it might be that we need that help because of the distractions of the world, the distractions of our everyday lives. Faith is in the heart, but it is also in the understanding why Easter took place. I'm aware that when Reverend Jeff Floyd did one of the Easter, the Holy Week reflections, he mentions understanding. And he mentions that it's not possible to have perfect understanding. I mean, that I accept entirely. We will never have perfect understanding, but having understanding of the reason why Easter was what Easter was is so important. And think of the disciples. They finally got it. And what a moment for them, what joy for them to have understood the scriptures and understood why Jesus was crucified, died, and then risen. Finally, I'd like you to go back to your list of important things, issues, circumstances. and reflect on them. And reflect on the importance of understanding Easter in our Christian faith. And it might be that you would want to revise your list, and maybe somewhere on the list that you put, if you've not already done so, understanding the significance and importance of Easter in our Christian faith. May God protect you and guide you now and always. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Thank you.
Well, that's about it for today's service. But I'd like to say a big thank you for all those who've taken part, both in front and behind the camera. It's wonderful to be part of a great team where we can all use our different gifts. I hope that in the days and weeks to come, you'll have your own personal encounter with Jesus, and you'll be as excited to meet with the risen Lord as those first disciples were. Molly and I will be going back up to check on the sheep again soon, but before I go, I'd like to share a blessing with you all. May the beauty of God be reflected in your eyes. May the love of God be reflected in your hands. May the wisdom of God be reflected in your words. And may the knowledge of God flow from your heart so that all might see and believe in him. Amen.
Thank you for your company today. If you're watching on YouTube, it will be helpful to us if you could subscribe to our channel. Just press the subscribe button and the bell.